Once, when I was little, I heard that boas could swallow a whole elephant. The image had stayed with me all day, and I decided to draw it. All the grown-ups were telling me the same thing. The hat looks great. They didn't understand. They just kept telling me to do something with myself, like study geography or maths. I took their advice and became an aviator, a job that allowed me to travel the planet and live the life the way they've always wanted me to. I've been living in an adult's world for several years now, but I have never felt comfortable. I felt sad and frustrated. I've always been the weird one in a world where everyone was alike. One day, while I was flying over the desert, my plane had an engine problem, and it fell on the ground. It was just the dunes and myself, surrounded by a sea of silence. If I couldn't manage to take off, I wouldn't survive. All of a sudden, a little blue-eyed boy appeared in front of my very eyes. He was the little prince.
Can you paint a lamb for me?
I looked for the color markers in my backpack, and I drew the three lambs. But he didn't like any of them. One was old, and the other was ill-looking, or too thin. I was tired of him insisting so much that I drew a box reassuring him that the lamb he wanted was in there.
Oh, that's exactly what I wanted.
The little prince lived on a small, faraway planet. There were volcanoes on this planet, and the land was covered with enormous baobab trees. The little prince liked watching the sunsets very much. He knew how to enjoy the little things in life. He paid attention to the small details and to all those moments, invisible to adult eyes. He told me that there existed two types of plants on every planet: good plants and bad plants. Bad plants should be ripped out immediately, because their huge roots could make a small planet like this one explode.
Why do roses have thorns?
The little prince asked me one day. So that animals won't eat them, I replied.
But they eat them anyway.
In that case, I don't know. I've got important things to do. We're lost in the desert. And if I don't fix my plane, we'll die.
Important things? Roses have had thorns for millions of years. Don't you think it's important to ask you about them?
I went closer and I gave him a hug. He was right. In the adult world, important things are numbers or doing business. People don't appreciate the small details in the world around us. Unique flowers grew on the little prince's planet, flowers that only lived one day. But one day, a different flower grew on the planet. It was incredibly beautiful and a little selfish. Besides, the flower thought it was invincible because it had four thorns. It was a vain flower and always demanded the little prince's attention.
That flower gave my life meaning. I should have never run away, but I was too young for love.
The little prince was talking about the day he said goodbye to his flower to set off on his journey around several planets.
I love you. You have decided to leave, so do it and try to be happy. I'll be okay. I have four thorns to defend myself.
The first planet the little prince visited was ruled by a king.
My first subject,
exclaimed the king when he saw him. The little prince was confused to hear him say that. The king explained that all the universe had to obey him.
And you can demand anything you want?
Asked the little prince.
No, one should always demand what people are able to do.
I think there's nothing for me to do here. I have to go.
The king tried to hold back the little prince in every possible way. He even named him minister of the realm. Nothing could change his mind. He had to continue with his journey, and no king's authority could stop him. He kept thinking, adult people are so weird. On the next planet lived a vain person.
Oh, an admirer, said the vain man. Start applauding me till I tell you to stop.
After applauding for a while, the little prince got tired and stopped.
You admire me very much, don't you?
What does it mean to admire someone?
To admire someone is the same as admitting that I am the prettiest, the most intelligent, and the best person on this planet.
But you are the only one on this planet. Why do you want people to admire you?
The little prince was definitely realizing that older people were very weird. What they did made no sense. The little prince told me that the third planet was inhabited by a businessman. He was as red as a tomato, and he did calculations all the time.
2 million! Next month I'll earn double!
2 million what?
Stars! I'll have 2 million stars!
And what do you do with 2 million stars?
I count them and I put them in the bank.
But that's pointless. You're not useful to them.
The little prince left, thinking again how very weird older people are. The fourth planet was small. There was only one lamp post and a lamp lighter.
Why do you turn the lamp on and off all the time?
It's my duty. I have to turn the lamppost on at night and turn it off in the morning. But now that the planet is smaller, the sun sets every 5 minutes.
And your job has always been the same?
Yes. The planet has changed, but my job stayed the same. I have no time to rest, even though my job is what I like the most. The little prince thought that the lamplighter was the least absurd of all other people. He had a job, and he worried about something else aside himself. Be that as it may, he only thought about doing his duty. The last planet he visited was the biggest one and was inhabited by an old man who was a geographer and knew where the oceans, the mountains, and the deserts were.
So, are there many seas on your planet?
I don't know. I'm a geographer, not an explorer. I count on the explorers to inform me about everything they see.
Do you also know about flowers? They are the prettiest thing on my planet.
No, I'm not interested in flowers because they decay fast and disappear. I like mountains better because they never change.
At that very moment, the little prince regretted having left his flower alone. One day, the flower would disappear too. Finally, the little prince arrived on Earth. 7 million people lived on that planet. Among them, there were lamplighters and thousands of vain people. When the little prince got there, he saw a field of roses that reminded him of his flower. Then he came across a very beautiful animal.
Who are you? You look very pretty.
I'm a fox.
Come play with me. I'm very sad.
I can't. I'm not domesticated.
What does it mean to be domesticated?
It means to have a bond with someone. To me, you're just another boy, and I don't need you for anything. But if you domesticate me, we'll grow fond of each other and we'll end up needing one another. I want you to domesticate me. You should be very patient with me. At first, you'll feel distant, but little by little, we'll get closer.
The little prince understood what the fox was saying and started domesticating it little by little. He visited the fox every day and played with it, till one day they had to say goodbye.
I'm going to cry.
Go have a look at the field of roses. Then come back and I'll tell you a secret.
The little prince did exactly what the fox asked him to, and he realized that contrary to the rest of the roses, his rose was unique and special, because the flower had been domesticated by him, and he by the flower. The rest of the roses were beautiful, but they were meaningless.
What really matters is invisible to the eyes,
told him the fox before saying goodbye.
Come on, let's look for a well.
A well? We're in the desert. But the little prince wouldn't give up. If he wanted something, he would get it.
What really makes a desert more beautiful is the well underground. What makes something beautiful is invisible to the eyes.
The little prince had fallen asleep, and I kept walking, holding him in my arms as if he were a treasure. It was then when we found the well and drank from it. It seemed that water sprung as a reward from walking under the stars and all our hard efforts. It was a gift from the heart, like when I used to look at Christmas lights as a kid. The little prince was near the well, and I went closer to see him. When I got there, I saw him talking to a snake. It looked very dangerous. He was pale as snow. He looked at me, and then I understood everything. I fixed my plane.
I'm glad. I'm going back home too, although my journey is much longer and more complicated.
We were standing in a desert in daylight, but I felt frozen. I couldn't believe I'd never hear his laughter again. Tell me this is all a bad dream. I don't want you to go.
Let me set off on this journey alone.
All of a sudden, there was a lightning, and the little prince fell on the desert sand. Many years had gone by. I knew that the little prince went back to his planet because on the next morning, his little body wasn't there. To me, Sahara Desert is the most beautiful and saddest place in the world. It was there where I first saw the little prince, and it was also there where he disappeared. If you ever find yourselves there, don't rush away. Enjoy the sights. Never lose the kid you have inside, because what's really beautiful is invisible to the eyes, and only kids are able to see with their heart.
In a village in La Mancha, the name of which I have no desire to recall, lived Alonso Quijano, most commonly known as Don Quixote. Don Quixote loved books so much, he would spend entire hours reading them. Without a doubt, his favorite stories were about the great knights in old Spain. As Don Quixote read through these novels about great deeds of chivalry and accomplishments, he started confusing fantasy with reality. In like manner, he strived to imitate the heroes in the stories, becoming a knight errant.
The world needs brave men like myself to fight for justice against evil. From now onwards, I'll go down in history as Don Quixote de la Mancha.
Don Quixote made all the necessary arrangements to become a knight, like those in his books. He went up to the attic and found an armor. He laid his hands on an old spear and a dented shield which he had to fix.
I almost forgot, I will also need a horse.
He went down to the stables and there found Rosinante, a skinny old nag. Just then, his neighbor Sancho, a kind, chubby peasant was passing by. Don Quixote remembered right away that he also needed a companion in his wanderings.
Dear Sancho, every knight needs a faithful squire and adventurous companion. I can't promise you the world, but if we win fortune and glory, I'll grant you the privilege of becoming the governor of an isle.
Sancho was slightly naive, so he believed him and accepted the proposal. And this was how such an atypical pair set off seeking adventures. Their neighbors couldn't believe their eyes. What were these lunatics up to? They laughed at them for hours, but couldn't stop them. Don Quixote, Sancho, and Rosinante were strolling along the plains of La Mancha when they saw some windmills at a distance.
Sancho, my friend, do you see those enormous giants? I shall do battle with them unto the death. Stop their evil deeds.
Which giants, my lord?
Those, over there, in the distance. There are at least 30 of them. Can't you see how huge their arms are?
Those aren't giants, Don Quixote. They're windmills. And those that look like arms to you aren't arms. They are the blades that spin around with the wind.
Sancho, fear doesn't let you see clearly. Step aside. I'll battle them. Don't run away, coward creatures!
Sancho's warnings didn't do any good. The blades pushed Don Quixote off his horse. Both himself and Rosinante fell on the ground, badly injured.
My lord, I told you they weren't giants. They were windmills. But you didn't listen. Hush, Sancho. It's magician Freston's fault, who changed the giants into windmills to deprive me of victory. But I won't give up. The power of my sword is greater than the magician's evil doing.
Sancho Panza helped his lord up. He treated his wounds, and they both set off once again in search for more adventures.
Sancho, my friend, every knight needs to have a fair lady to dream of and to honor with his heroic deeds. Because a knight without love is like a tree without leaves.
Don Quixote had chosen Dulcinea del Toboso, a young peasant girl, whom he idealized and decided she'd become the lady of his dreams. Don Quixote decided to write a letter to his beloved.
Sovereign and exalted lady, sweetest Dulcinea del Toboso, your absence hurts dearly my heart, my fair beloved. I dream about the day we'll meet again and you'll heal my wounds. Forever yours, the Knight of the Sad Countenance.
Don Quixote set out on his new path together with Sancho. Suddenly, he saw a thick cloud of dust. A vast army was approaching with the capacity to defeat them. Sancho warned him of such insanity.
There's no vast army of soldiers. It's just a large flock of sheep.
Don Quixote didn't listen and pounced at the sheep. He hurt a lot of them with his spear and stepped on many others with his horse.
Hey!
The shepherds were furious, and they started throwing stones at him. So many that both Sancho and Don Quixote had to flee with great speed. Don Quixote felt exhausted. Nightlife wasn't the way he had imagined it to be. He had come across with nothing but mockery, attacks, and disappointments. And this was how Don Quixote commenced his journey back home, where other adventures were waiting for him. Those told in the books he loved reading so much. This story, written by the famous author Miguel de Cervantes, is great in length and filled with adventures like the ones we told you about. How would you like to read the whole novel?
Snow White lived in New York. She was a secretary for her stepmom's style magazine. However, her true passion was something different. Snow White wanted to be a cook and make people feel good. Her stepmother was the director of the magazine and was jealous of her intelligence.
Mirror, mirror, who is the smartest writer of them all?
You search for smartest writer of them all. The answer is Snow White.
Liar! How dare you?
It was Monday and Snow White got up to go to work. Something inside her said, follow your dreams. She said goodbye to her stepmother, packed her suitcase, and bought the first flight she found to Spain. On CookAdvisor, a social media site dedicated to cooking, she had read that Spain was a country rich in food and cooking. Her stepmom was really angry. Snow White had accidentally taken her recipe book, without realizing that her mother hid all of her evil intentions inside it. She had to find it. Snow White finally made it to the famous Seven Chefs restaurant. It was located in a small town in Spain. There wasn't anyone there, so she went into the kitchen. Everything was a mess, and the dishes still weren't ready. Then, she started to mix some ingredients. A little bit of pepper, a little bit of curry.
What are you doing in our kitchen?
Said a voice, surprising Snow White. Snow White turned around and saw seven little guys with giant chef hats all staring at her.
I am Snow White, and I want to learn how to cook.
You should be careful before going into our kitchen,
said one of them while trying a little bit of cake.
This is delicious!
Everyone started to try Snow White's dishes while they gossiped.
We all want you to help us. Achoo!
Explained another one.
You'll begin as the chef's helper,
exclaimed Grumpy. Snow White was really happy. She was learning to make different dishes and many people were trying them. Snow White always helped with her generosity, humility, and goodness.
Be careful with the spices. They all add strong flavors.
Dopey didn't talk, and Bashful always got red because he was always embarrassed.
Achoo! I think I got that cold from last week again.
Sleepy was always tired, and you could even fall asleep in the kitchen. And lastly, Happy was the one that helped the most. While Snow White was happy because of her kindness, her stepmother was unhappy due to her vanity and jealousy. She always asked the mirror who was the best rider of them all, and she always got angry when the mirror said Snow White. She searched for Snow White with an investigator, but she didn't have any luck. Suddenly, she received an email. She had finally found Snow White. She could get her book back. She caught the first flight to Spain. Her future with the magazine was in great danger. She dressed up like a chef in the Pinchelin guide and took with her a secret apple pie. Snow White was alone in the restaurant.
Are you the famous Snow White?
Asked her stepmother.
I'm Ava Criticale from the Pinchelin guide.
Snow White did not recognize her stepmother all dressed up, and she asked her to come in.
Try my delicious apple pie,
offered the stepmother. Snow White ate a small piece of the apple pie, and suddenly she started to feel sick and she fainted. Her stepmother was searching the chef's whole house and leaving everything a mess. Suddenly, someone opened the door. It was the seven chefs. The first thing they saw was Snow White on the floor.
Snow White!
They all shouted without waking her up. Suddenly, Sleepy found a paper on the floor. It said,
Nobody will be able to wake up Snow White, and my secret will never be revealed. Only the best dish of them all will be able to save her.
Then, Doc had a great idea. Doc called Anthony Fryer, the best chef in the world. Only his dishes would be able to save Snow White. Fryer had heard many things about Snow White's dishes, and he was really wanting to meet her. He made his famous apple mousse. He got on his way from his town in his fancy car. Chef Fryer took out his apple mousse. Its smell filled the room. Little by little, Snow White started to wake up. She couldn't believe what she saw. It was Anthony Fryer, her idol. From that day on, Anthony Fryer helped the seven chefs in their restaurant. It soon became the best in the world. All of the stepmother's secrets were revealed, and because of them, she went to jail. If you have a dream, you should never stop chasing it, regardless of the obstacles. If you are a good person and you don't get taken away by jealousy and selfishness, you will definitely achieve your dreams.
Cinderella will always remember the last thing her mother said to her. Be good to others and always try your best. It had been 3 years since her mom had passed away from the X90 virus. Her dad got married to another woman who had two daughters, Carrie and Lucy. A few months later, Cinderella's dad got sick with the X90 virus, and he was hospitalized. Since her dad couldn't come home, Cinderella's stepmother and stepsisters ordered her to make YouTube videos and take care of all their social media. When she had time, Cinderella also did research about the virus.
Barucella, I don't like the music that you put on this video. Our YouTube channel is really important to our follower.
Make the video again! Change the music and use a softer filter!
Cinderella spent the whole night making the videos for her stepsisters. After, she looked at Listus's blog. He was a very famous researcher that was really close to finding a cure to the X90 virus that her dad had.
Maybe one day, my work can help him!
Sighed Cinderella while leaving him a comment on his blog.
Cinderella, we are coming to help you! Johnny and Robbie, offering us help!
You're always here when I need you. Finally, I was brave enough to write Listus. Now, I just need to finish the algorithm.
Wake up, Cinderella. An invitation for the dance has arrived, and your stepsisters are in charge of talking about the guest's clothes.
Listus is going to go.
Am I going to have to make those videos? And also meet Listus?
Exactly. There are 20 videos of the spring collection for YouTube. and you'll have to find something to wear. You can't go in those rags.
Don't worry, Cinderella. John and I will help you finish the videos and make a marvelous dress. With the new 3D printer, we will have it ready in a jiffy.
Cinderella saw that she had a lot of messages on her computer.
Your work is so interesting. You're almost finished. Keep it up.
He read my comment on the blog. Why are you so happy? Tomorrow, I will have your videos and my dress. I'm going to the party.
Said Cinderella, smiling, with Carrie left mad. The morning of the dance...
Cinderella, you didn't know that we wanted those videos in Russian? You can't go to the party.
Suddenly, the smartphone turned on and someone spoke. Said Siri, casting a cyber spell.
Print the dress! Print the medicine Russian! Big Mommy! A big John you will be! Johnny! Remember that the dress microchip is programmed until midnight. Afterwards, the dress will lose its shape and Johnny will no longer be big!
The stepsisters were dancing with Listus, but he didn't want to dance with them.
Listus, don't go too far!
We want to take some pictures and a video with you.
Suddenly, Cinderella's dress lit up with the party spotlights, and you could see the printed code from her work. Listus came up to Cinderella.
Your dress is very original. The design is incredible. Is it printed in 3D?
Yes, it is my printed work.
It is really interesting. Let's talk about it.
Right then, the alarm rang on the smartphone.
I have to go! It's midnight!
Listus ran and managed to pick up part of her dress that had fallen.
It is the last part of the algorithm! I need to know who that girl is!
Everyone up! Listus posted that he is looking for the mysterious girl from the party. She had the really important code!
Maybe that was what was missing from the code in the dress! Yesterday, a piece of it ripped. I will send it to him,
thought Cinderella.
The blog's algorithm is the same as Virus X90's.
Listus called Cinderella and he knew it was her. Together, they finished the algorithm. They found a cure for her dad and finally he could come home. Thanks to her hard work, Cinderella got a job in a lab with Listus. And she had everything she had ever dreamed of. Now it's your turn. Try your best, and you will achieve everything you set your mind to.
It was Christmas Eve, and while everyone was dancing at the Christmas party, Clara and Jack were opening the presents their godfather had brought for them. Jack's present was a fun cooking video game to cook his recipes. His sister Clara got a smartphone to watch her ballet videos. Clara saw a small robot dressed like a soldier. It was a Nutcracker.
Can I play with the Nutcracker?
Clara asked her godfather.
Of course you can.
Everyone had already gone and Clara had fallen asleep on the couch in the living room. The cuckoo clock struck midnight when Clara woke up. She opened her eyes to see that the living room was full of computer mice moving nonstop all over the place. And there were some gingerbread soldiers on the table. They were Jack's video game soldiers fighting with their laser swords, and their leader was the Nutcracker. It was unbelievable. The Nutcracker's army was fighting the mice when the Nutcracker got trapped by a huge rat-like robot who was wearing a golden crown. It was the Rat King. Clara armed herself with courage and joined the gingerbread army to rescue the Nutcracker with everyone's help. She managed to kick that huge rat down, freeing the Nutcracker from its claws. This was how Clara, the Nutcracker, and his army won the battle.
Thank you for saving me, Clara. Without your help, we could never win the battle.
Hypnotized, she followed the Nutcracker to the kitchen. The Nutcracker started pressing some microwave buttons, and a colored ray of light was projected on the wall. a magic portal opened. Clara crossed the portal without doubting it for a second. When she opened her eyes again, she just couldn't believe what she was looking at. Clara looked around. Everything was made of candy. Strawberry gum floors and cotton candy clouds, a milk river, and toffee cookie houses.
Welcome to the land of sweets, Clara.
Clara turned around and saw a woman with dark complexion, wearing a beautiful dress.
Hello, Clara. I'm the Sugar Plum Fairy. We've been waiting for you. Come with me.
They went into the palace, entering the big hall room made of sugar and toffee.
Welcome to my palace.
Thank you. Your realm is incredible. But why have you been waiting for me?
We need you, Clara. Your courage and bravery will be much needed if we want to beat the Rat King. He's been ruling the four realms for too long now.
We have to run away. The Rat King's army is here.
The Nutcracker and his army fled to the land of flowers. This was a forest with dancing flowers. Clara was overwhelmed with everything that was going on around her, till she saw the Rat King's army reaching from afar.
We have to get to the land of snow before they come any closer.
The Nutcracker grabbed Clara's hand and ran with her to the next realm. They got to a gigantic football stadium. This was the land of sports, where rooftops were rackets and traffic lights looked like changing colored baseball bats. The Nutcracker's army got ready for battle, joined by all four realms. The Rat King didn't want to surrender, and in his despair, he took Clara. The Nutcracker threw a huge ball to strike the Rat King down, and he made it. They had won the battle with the Rat King fighting all together, side by side. Life in all four realms went back to normal. They were free at last. The Sugar Plum Fairy threw a party in the land of snow to celebrate the occasion. Everything was covered with snow, and there was a huge Christmas tree, all lit up, standing in the middle. The people of the four realms were right there dancing. The toffee soldiers, the flowers, the sportsmen, the snowmen. Clara and the Nutcracker were dancing together a song when everything changed. Clara could only see small rays of light, and all of a sudden, she was back on her couch. She didn't know where the Nutcracker had gone. He seemed to have disappeared. It was then when everyone came into the living room.
What's the matter, Clara?
Asked her mother.
Nothing, Mom. I was just having a beautiful dream.
Look, dear,
said Clara's father.
This is Nathaniel.
She looked at the boy. He was blonde with blue eyes and had a smile Clara knew well. It was him. Had it all been a dream? If you're brave, you can live thousands of adventures. Imagine all you can accomplish working as a team with others, just like Clara and the Nutcracker did. So, find a trusty friend to share your adventures with and never stop dreaming.
We've learned so much in just one video. Did you know there are many more videos? Imagine how much you could learn. Subscribe to the Smile and Learn educational channel to learn and have fun at the same time.